Time for everybody in the community. I'm just speaking to you this morning. In fact, everyone that's in our lives is consumed by what we're really talking about. We all deal with it in one form or another. And we're going to take a look at a young man who became king at the age of 12 years old. Also, what we're going to talk about this morning, he had many things that occurred in his life and actually brought him to a place to where he had to get in or not. So that's really Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. And this is where closely as the reader reads this.
O foolish Galatians, who have bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you. This is only what I learned of you.
That's what I'm right here. I'm going to go back and emphasize on that. In the introduction of the reading, it says, O foolish Galatians, which means at one time before this occurred, they were wise. But something occurred to cause them to become foolish. Oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? And that word bewitched takes from the meaning or the realm of some type of divine force that's stronger than the human force. And said, this force has bewitched you, or this force has influenced you to change from once what you was doing to something else. Now you have you in a position to where you're not receiving what you once received. He said, oh, foolish Galatians, who have bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? In other words, what did you hear? What did you see? What did you feel? It called you to change from the truth to something else. This morning I want to talk to you about influence. When I say influence, there's not a person in this building this morning that you was not influenced, or you wouldn't have been here. You were influenced. And as a matter of fact, right now, you're influenced by everybody around you in this room. Even though we're in different places, we're still influenced by the presence of the person here. And so this morning, I'm here to actually not force upon you, but to drive to you the influence that I have and where it's coming from. So it's my job to influence you to hear this truth. Take this truth, live by the truth, and get the benefit from that truth. There is nothing in life, there's nothing we do. Every morning when we get up out of the bed and we begin to proceed through our day, we're influenced by something, time, places, things, whatever. When you have certain things you're going to do that day, you're influenced by the time frame in which they're going to be done. You're influenced by the intensity of what has to be done. So influence is something that you cannot evade. Your very life of existence is based on influence. And then that we know, simply put, that there is good influence and there is bad influence. And from the reading of the scripture, we found that this group of people who Paul is talking to now, he said, you have become foolish because you got influenced not to obey the truth after you received it. So the question that he's asking them is a twofold question. The twofold question is, the one question is, who influenced your mind? Two, and what did your mind influence you to do? That's not foolish. Catch it? And so, when we look into this, we must really pay attention to what the the question he's asking them, because the question of what he's asking them, he's trying to draw their attention back to the original place that they were, that was a blessing to them, that was good for them. Now all of a sudden, and I won't tell you, but in a period of time, something occurs. Now think about this. Think about this. Influence is driven by the power of your emotions, your passions, and your feelings. There are two entryways that actually now begins to cause influence to occur. The two entryways inside of you is your eyes and your ears. And once you see something or hear something, you're influenced by it. And the intensity of the influence is how you take on the emotions and the passions and the feelings of what you heard or what you saw. Many times the influence is great by who we hear it from or who we see it from. And there always seems like to me there's two little voices on each of our shoulders that are constantly talking to us. And we turn one ear to listen to this one, and we turn this ear to listen to that one. And then what we decide in the power of our emotion is going to influence to act from whichever voice we heard. How many ever got involved in something that later on you wish you had never, ever got involved in? But then you gotta go back, why did I get involved? Why did I get influenced? It all comes from hearing or seeing. Huh? And influence cannot influence you until you act upon it. Then the act of influence now becomes you become now what you've been influenced by. I want you to turn with me to the book of Romans, the 14th chapter. I want to be cognizant of the time. I got something I really want to share with us this morning. And the reason why this word is important is because of all of us have future lives. If God bless you, you live tomorrow. But this day is important. What you feel influenced by this day can affect you tomorrow and the next day and the next day. As a matter of fact, your life has been influenced from the very day you were born. And you became cognitive within your mind and aware of what's going on. You've been influenced by mother, father, siblings, so forth. You've been influenced by schoolmates, on and on. You've been influenced by relatives, situations. You've been influenced by those things. And sometimes, if we don't learn how to get rid of the negative influences, you live those in your life. And you wonder, what is going on? What's going on? You have not stopped being influenced by something negative that happened to you in your past. Somebody has said a negative word to you, and you take that in, and somebody else can come along and say the same thing, and you can influence. You're mad at them, but they only said something that was said, but you were influenced by something that was said before that. And so many times we're placing blame on people in the now, when really the blame is on the people in the past that you allowed them to influence you. Read the book of Romans, the 14th chapter, and the 7th verse.
For none of us liveth to himself.
See that? You do not live to yourself. You do not live to yourself. I don't care if you're single, you live by yourself. You're not living to yourself. Because yourself needs too many variables for you to live. And in the variables, you're going to be influenced by those variables. When I use the term variable, it can be people, places, and things. It can be the very variable of your intelligence and your education. So no man lives unto himself. You're not like the song said, you're not a lonely island. Somebody's on there with you. As a matter of fact, there's nobody else on there with you but you. Because you will eventually talk to yourself. And you get influenced by what you say to yourself. So who told you that? And you think that's it. I did. But influence never happens without some outside force being there. It never occurs. So how vital is what this message is speaking on today? Influence. Influence is what determines or will determine our outcomes. Our outcomes. Read.
For none of us liveth to himself.
None lives to himself.
And no man dieth to himself.
Now watch this. How many of you from know somebody else that's in this room? They may not live with you, but they influence you. They may not go home with you today, but they influence you. They will influence you because of some prior enactment that you had with them, some conversation that they had with them, some experience you had with them. And even though we're in this room, we all go to the same house, every one of us in here is influencing each other. We have yesterday have been influenced to see what type of atmosphere is going to be developed to see if they feel welcome or not. So they got influenced by the atmosphere that they walked in, and you're a part of that. Huh?
Whether we live, we live unto the Lord.
We live unto the Lord.
And whether we die, we die unto the Lord.
Read.
Whether we live therefore,
or die,
we are the Lord's.
We are the Lord's. Now, what is this saying? The final analysis of influence should be that influence that we get influenced by God. Because he's sovereign, he's all-knowing. I don't care if you know the truth, they're not all-knowing. He's all-powerful. And you're not omnipresent, because you can't be at the same place at the same time living. You're here, and you're not home. So your presence is right here. And so now you're being influenced by the presence that you're here. And then when you walk into your house, you get influenced by that influence of the house. Let me tell you something. Every room in your house has an influence on you. Let me say this. Every room you walk in your house has an influence on you. If it's party time, you got to get influenced by the bathroom. And the bathroom is so influenced by that you have certain things there to take care of your business that you got to take care of. So even the toilet tissue influences you. So I want you to grasp the fact how easy we can be influenced. But the most important thing is what we are influenced by. And what is going to be the outcome of that influence? Read.
Verse 9. For to this end, Christ both died.
Yes.
And rose. And revived.
Yes.
That he might be Lord both of the dead and living.
That he might be Lord both of the dead and living. Let's go to the Old Testament scripture. In the book of 2 Chronicles, let's take a look at this episode here of a young man at a very early age. He became king over the nation, over people, and how that his life was greatly influenced by his past. Do you not know that you can be influenced by really beautiful, this young man. This young man's father was a good father. He was a good king. The Bible said he walked upright before God. As a matter of fact, the Bible said he took out things that were in the temple that was not in line with God. He caused the nation to walk before God. But his son, when he got in line, he operated opposite of his father. You would think that he got influenced by the rightness of his father, but he done everything opposite of what his father done. And I thought about that. I said, what about kids that have been raised up in good Christian homes or godly families or families that told them right, and they just go clean off in left field as though they had no home training? And I thought about it. I said, Lord, why is that? He said, because those kids are influenced by themselves to wonder, what am I missing? I've been getting all this truth. This is all I know. But I still remember the world out there that looks like people are having fun and having a good time. So what I'm being influenced by what I see. Now, what I've been influenced by doesn't match up with what I see. So I want to experience. I never drank, but I want to experience it. I never smoked, but I want to experience it. Because when people are smoking, they make it so cool. They blow up through their nose, they blow up through their mouth, they blow up the front of their mouth, they blow up the side of their mouth. Right? And it looks like it tastes so good. And then you get caught up in the emotion of the feeling of what that looks like. So how can it be so bad if it looks so good? How could it be so bad if it feels so good? So since all I've known is what's right, and then as I grow up, I go to something different, is because I've been influenced by what I see and said, now let me experience this for myself so I can know what's going on. We already know what's going on because the parents already told you that's going to destroy you. But you don't believe it's going to destroy you because you haven't experienced it. So you think, let me experience it, let me see, just if that's what it's going to turn out to be. But the problem of it is, when you go to experience it, you can't reverse it. You go into it. We draw something that it ain't going to work. Some of y'all, right now, you got this stuff, you say, it ain't going to work out like that. And it ended up working out the same way. And you'll say, well, my mama told me that. She told me, Daddy told me not to do that. Huh? And so the reason I'm bringing this out is because Manasseh, this 12-year-old king whose father was Hezekiah, who died, he automatically comes into kingship. And so now he is to lead God's people, that kingdom. And all that Hezekiah done was show him what was right, taught him what was right, showed him what was right. But Manasseh, when you read the history of him, he goes totally opposite. Like he had no home training whatsoever. Like he had never heard any truth. So I ask myself the question, how did he get influenced? How did he get persuaded? Since he had one example, how did he get persuaded? He got persuaded in the influence of his imagination. Y'all get that? He got influenced in the imagination because he was seeing these other nations do this, these other gods are doing this, and this boy was something else. He got so caught up in what he got influenced. He was taking little children and making them go through the fire and burn up because he was serving this God called Moloch, and he wanted those children to be a sacrifice to this God, believing that this God would bless the nation. He never saw that messed up out of his father, Hezekiah. Huh? As a matter of fact, Hezekiah cleaned the temple, and his son comes back and puts all these idols and everything in the temple of God, and when the people worship him, he went totally opposite of what he was taught. But the key thing is, we know this, but the key thing you gotta recognize, he had to be influenced by something. Go to 2 Chronicles chapter 33. And let's look at this. Begin with the first verse.
Manasseh was 12 years old.
12 years old.
When he began to reign.
Yes.
And he reigned 50 and 5 years in Jerusalem.
55 years, uh-huh.
But did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord.
That's not what he saw. But he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord. Read.
Like unto the abominations of the heathen.
But he did it according to what he was looking at. Right? He didn't see anything out of his father's in that manner. But he said he did it according to the abominations of the other nations that he saw, because he was so inquisitive, he wanted to experience the feelings of what they felt, of what they was dealing with. For some reason in his mind, he thought what they were doing was so much better than what he was taught to do. This is how I can parenting class. Because you said to me, why'd you go that route? That's not what I taught you. Huh? And you're scratching your head, hair getting gray, scratching bald spots, wondering why they turned the way they turned when all you taught them was good, 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 good. And then when they turn, you get influenced and you feel bad because you think you didn't teach them right. No, it wasn't that you didn't teach them right. They got influenced by someone else. Read.
But did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord.
He did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord.
Like unto the abominations of the heathen.
Yes.
Whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel.
Now he has seen God cast these other people out from among them because God cast them out because it wasn't right. Huh? That should have been an example right there. Read.
For he built again the high places which Hezekiah his father had broken down.
Yes.
And he reared up altars for Baal, and made groves, and worshipped all the host of heaven and served.
Now he had seen his father tear all this down when he became king. The kingdom before him, he tore all of that down because he knew that was not in favor of God Jehovah. And he had seen his father tear all these things down, and he turned around and reveals them. So we see him in open defiance because of influence. Oh, that was powerful. I just missed that. So you get it. You get it in open defiance because of what you influenced by. By what you influenced by. And I've seen it many, many times. I've been preaching, pastoring before some years. I've seen it many, many times where we've had the young people get raised up in this church, go the right way, and they go, haul off. Well, why? Because God said, I want to experience that for myself so I can know. Well, you already know the outcome because it's been chosen. But I don't believe the outcome until I can live the outcome. Huh? And sometimes we as people got to do the same thing with God. He tells us what the outcome is going to be. but we want to limit ourselves to just see if maybe God ain't telling us all of it. Maybe God just holds something back. He knows this thing is so good, he's just trying to hold me back. He is. God will hold you back to be the truth. Read.
Verse 4.
Uh-huh.
Also, he built altars in the house of the Lord.
He built altars. Think about it. He built idol altars in the house of the Lord. It would be just, let me give you a picture for a baby. It would be just like you walk in this church and there's a devil altar up there with devil's heads and horns and witches and brews on it in the house of God. You look at that and took y'all turn around and run out there so fast. You say, what in the world is wrong with what is going on here? Huh? But Manasseh did that in the house of God. Read.
Word of the Lord had said, in Jerusalem shall my name be forever.
Yes.
And he built altars for all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord.
Read.
And he caused his children.
Now listen to this. And he would do what?
And he caused his children to pass through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. Also he observed times and used enchantments. And used witchcraft.
Witchcraft.
And dealt with a familiar spirit.
Familiar spirits.
And with wizards.
Wizards.
He wrought much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger.
To provoke him to anger. But he never saw that out of his father. He's a God. So the text that everyone will get to is what? Oh, is influencing me to do what I'm doing? What or who is influencing me to do what I'm doing? And then you're going to get this influence that's going to do this. What is going to be the outcome? What's going to be the end result? So how many in this room today want good? So then you gotta ask yourself, is there anything influencing me that I can't get? Is there anything, is there somebody influencing me that I can't get the good? Because you said that's what you want, right? So that means if that's what you want, then you gotta go back and deal with what's influencing you to make sure you can get it. Does that make sense? Read.
Verse 7. And he set a carved image, the idol which he had made in the house of God, of which God had said to David and to Solomon his son.
These are the forefathers of Hezekiah, the grandfathers of Manasseh. And David and Solomon was following the ways of God. That's what they're reading back to. And in this house, what?
And in Jerusalem.
Yes.
Which I have chosen before all the tribes of Israel.
Yes.
Will I put my name forever?
That they put the name of God in the temple. You come along and take the name of God out of the temple. Read.
Neither will I anymore remove the foot of Israel from out of the land which I have appointed to your fathers.
Yes.
So that they will take heed
to me. Now here's what he said. He said, I made a promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I made a promise to all of your fathers. I made a promise to your father. And he said, because they did not follow, I made the promise that I was going to give them or put them in the promised land, a land of milk and honey. I promised them good. But because they have been persuaded and influenced not to do good, he said they're not going to enter. They're not going to enter that good. Read.
So that they will take heed to do all that I have commanded them.
Now, y'all hear this? Well, I kind of understand what the preacher said about the Bible. Would you do that with your children? You give them instruction that you do this. You give them, do this, you don't get that. When they do it, you don't give it to them. Right? Hopefully. Hopefully. But if you're trying to be your child's buddy, you probably will. But if you're really going to be that parent, they need to understand you're receiving this because this is what you've done. This is what you brought up on yourself. So if you're mad, frustrated, disgusted, go back to yourself. Because it wasn't like I didn't tell you up front what was going to happen. As a matter of fact, I told you up front, I made you repeat it. But yet, after children do it and they get in trouble and the parent holds back video games or the phone or whatever, and that child just thinks that is so, that parent is so mean, they don't love me. They really show you that they loved you when they told you what was right to get the outcome you need to get. And then you can God send them. God said, do this and this, you can't have this and this. And then we go and don't get it, now we want to blame God. God don't love you, I don't care. But he already told us in the beginning, he said, I'm not a man that I can lie, nor the son of man I will repent, I don't do what I'm said to do. And you as friends, you got to do that with your children. You're going to do, you got to do, don't promise them a whooping and you're going to be able to. Because if you promise them a whooping and you don't give it, you need to let that child whoop you. Until that child say, I'm giving you what you promised to give me. Wow. And of course, it was the end time you go to jail for whipping children. But then you have to give them these, what they call, timeouts. But my mother whipped me and kept me out of jail. I never went to jail.
Amen.
And the Bible said, the Bible uses the term of Proverbs, you can beat them with a rod. God gave you permission. He made that backside cushion for the back. It's designed for a board. You don't hit them in the face. You hit them in the spot where God designed it. That's why you got all that cushion back there. Be your rights and they don't kill them. And that's some of you in this room today didn't go to jail because your mother whipped you. Now my mother didn't quite know the Bible. She whipped me with switches that I had to get from the tree. And she hit me anywhere that she could put it on me. If I raised my hand up, then it never gonna get it. I very seldom got it on the backside. But it didn't kill me. I am what I am today because of that. Because many times with parents, talking don't do no good. You know why? Because we don't keep a word after we talk. So we can influence our kids to be bad by the way we respond back to things. You see, kids. I don't know what I'm going to do with you. And me, son, God said, yeah, I don't know what I'm going to do with you. But God knows exactly what he's going to do. Read.
So that they will take heed to do all that I commanded
them. That is, that they will take heed to do what?
All that I commanded them.
That all that I commanded them. Read.
According to the whole law.
According to the whole law. I'm going to skip around here a little bit. And I want you to pick it up in the 10th verse of this 33rd chapter.
And the Lord spake to Manasseh.
And the Lord spake to Manasseh.
And to his people.
And to his people.
But they would not hearken.
But they would not hear. They were influenced. They would not hear. So when the word of God is going forth and you don't receive it, something's influencing you. Let me say it again. When the word of God is going forth and you don't receive that word or hear that word, when you intentionally block that word out, something is influencing you, and the biggest something that's influencing you is yourself. Read.
Wherefore the Lord brought upon them the captains of the host of the king of Assyria.
He said, now since you have been, I'm going to bring an enemy upon you. Now, it wasn't that God didn't love them that he brought the enemy. He brought the enemy because they weren't loving God and obeying God. God never does anything to you that you don't deserve. And then there's some things he don't give you that you deserve. But that's out of his mercy and his grace. But when Manasseh had outwritten the mercy and grace of God, he said, because you've done what you've done, you desecrated my house, you disobeyed me, you killed these children, made them walk through the fire, you're going to get this dilemma on you, and my grace is going to be in it. Is it going to change you or not? Wow, y'all messed up. Let me see. God's going to put all this on you, but then I'm going to give you grace to see if you're going to change. I'm going to put this on you to see if you're going to change. But if you change, you've got to put this on you and do something. So many times you think you're going through God, that's the grace of God to make you go through, to make you change, to do what you really need. Read.
Wherefore the Lord brought up one man, captains of the host,
yes,
king of Assyria, which took Manasseh among the thorns,
yes,
and bound him with fetters.
And took Manasseh the king, and bound him among the thorns. John here has got into a rose bush before. And see, like when you get a rose bush, it's hard to get out of. Because you move this way, it's finished here. You move this way, it's finished. So God let Manasseh, I'm going to say that, God let Manasseh get in a bunch of rose bushes. And no matter where you would turn, you would get stuck. To remind him the pain that you're feeling is the pain you brought upon yourself. Read.
He carried him to Babylon. And when he was in affliction. He besought the Lord his God.
He besought the Lord his God.
And humbled himself greatly.
And humbled himself greatly when he felt the affliction. But there's scripture on the word affliction. He said, they are the afflictions of the righteous. But the Lord delivereth them out of them all. God made Manasseh go through a space of real humiliation. Here he had ruled over his kingdom. But see, the Bible also tells us, it's in another scripture, that not only did Manasseh get caught up in the thorns, but the king put a hook in his nose with a chain and pulled him around the city. So people could say, look at this king being pulled around like to the ground. That was humiliating to Manasseh because he had reigned as a king of power, and he done this and he done that. And now God allowed the enemy not to only afflict him with thorns, but it exposed him to the public. And sometimes people won't come to God until they get exposed to public shame. Until they become publicized. Many times when you think he can keep you here, you don't deal with it. But when it's brought out on the surface, then you got to deal with that. You see, when it's brought on the surface, not only do you deal with that, but it deals with you, what you've been dealing with. Read.
And when he was in affliction, he besought the Lord his God.
Yes.
And humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers.
And what did he do?
And prayed unto him.
Now he's praying unto God when he was first rejecting God. Now he's praying unto the one who could have blessed him like he did his father blessed him. Now God blessed his father. He said, now because he's going through what he's going through, now he's turning to God. And the graciousness and the mercy of God accepted him even in spite of what he had done against God. You better be glad. That's the kind of God we serve. Because he will bring us back to him in spite of what we've done to him. You know why God does that? Because he's influenced by the love that he is. He does that because he's influenced by the love that he is. So God so loved us that he gave his only. And so God was influenced by his love. He said, I love. So I'm influenced by Manasseh turning to him. And when Manasseh turned to God, God turned to Manasseh. Read.
And prayed unto him, and he was entreated of him.
And he prayed unto him, and God, the word said, entreated means he prayed to God, and God welcomed him in spite of the life prior to what he had lived. So don't never, ever let the enemy say, God won't accept me because of my past. You've got to remember God is a God of a past, present, and future. He'll accept you in spite of your past and bring you to a future that you never had. So don't allow them to say, oh, you've been through this, and you've got this on the name, and this is going on. Turn to God. Turn to God and be influenced by God. Be influenced by his mercy. Be influenced by his grace. Be influenced by his son. Be ready to close. We have a change of the boss and take a little easy on that. Okay, he said, we don't want to go past that time, but I want you to really recognize what this message is saying. What is the key word in this message? What? Influence. What is the two syllables on the front of the word influence? That's what influence does. It goes in. It influences us from within. And what's within us? Our passions, our feelings, our desires. And influence influences that. As a matter of fact, our passions, desires, and feelings actually feed influence. To the point to where now we respond to a particular doing or outcome. That's exactly what Manasseh did. Exactly what he did. And it was only until he came to a point in his life that even with all of the power, prestige, honor that he had, when he had no more control, and he was at the mercy of God, that was the best place he could have gone. At the mercy of God. That's the best place you can be, is at the mercy of God. That is the absolute best place you can be, is at the mercy and the grace of God. And you say, my grace is sufficient. My grace is sufficient. That is the absolute best place to be. It was in the grace and the mercy of God. Even after things have influenced us to do what is actually robbing us from our blessings. In closing, in verses 12 and 13, let me say around 33, the fourth thing to the message, to find in God is when he saw me, humbled himself, and sorrow. Pray to God and then he made supplication to God to bring him back to Jerusalem. Those things that Nazarene calls God, as the Bible calls lament or change. Some of us need God to change mind us. God changed the mind about me. The best way to get God to change your mind, God already knows, but he wants you to be honest with him. And you tell him, God, this is what I am. This is what I do. This is how I think. This is what I struggle with. That's it. That then moves God to you, to forgive you, and to lift you up where you belong. There's a way, when things have been thrust us away from God, there's a way to get back. We used to sing a song, Lord, take me back to the first place I received you. Take me back. Take me back. And that's what Manasseh. When he began to pray before God and see God, he was now wanting God to take him back to where he saw his father live with God. He wanted now to live the blessing that he saw came through his father, Hezekiah. Even to the point his father, after he came into kingship for a period of time, and he became powerful as a nation, lived in pride. God sent a message to the church of Hezekiah, you're going to die. You're going to die. And when God said, because see, Hezekiah believed God because Hezekiah had the men of God, the prophets of God that would speak to him, and things would happen according to what God said. And when God sent a word to Hezekiah, you're going to die. Hezekiah went into his place of dwelling, where he laid to sleep, and he said, he turned his face to the wall. In other words, he turned his face to everything that had been influencing him. He turned his face from it and turned his face to the wall and said, Lord, here's what he said. He said, Lord, remember how I used to walk up before you? Do you remember how I used to humble myself before you? Now Hezekiah is playing on the remembrance of God to pull up that grace and mercy that God had on him in the past. Lord, remember that. And God remembered that and sent a word back to him. He said, because you've done what you've done, I'm going to add more years unto your life. Because Hezekiah broke, or allowed to be broken, those things that influenced him to get away from God. And if you want an addition in your life from God as a blessing, you're going to have to come back to that original place. Do like the prophets of old said, the people which are called by my name, if they will humble themselves and pray, and if they will seek my face and then turn, there's a process. Humble themselves to pray, seek my face, turn from that other way. He said, then I will cause heaven to hear, and they're going to get a response from heaven. I'm saying to us today, anything that's influencing us to the negative, if we do what the prophet said, call upon God, seek Him, turn to the Lord, repent, you're going to hear. You're going to hear. I want you today to be able to move in the influence of God, to influence God to give you mercy, to give you grace. Influence God to give you a look beyond your thoughts. See you. How many need God? How many need God? How many got thoughts? So we want Him to look beyond those and see the need. And He said in the Word, look at verse 18 and 20. He said, I will supply all of my needs. I'll supply all of your needs according to my riches in glory. In glory. And when that happens, you can testify and tell somebody, I have not seen, nor ear heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for them that love Him. Stand on your feet. Stand on your feet. Try out to be in the Hallelujah. My second influence.
Influence.
I want the influence of God. I want the influence of God. Father, today we appreciate you because you're God. You're sovereign. You sit high and you look low. You said, what is man that you are so mindful of him? Why is man in your mind? He said, because you are the highest creation of everything I created. I didn't create nothing except for you in my image and in my likeness. And because of that, I have an everlasting love concerning humanity. That even while we were yet sinners, He died for us. He gave His life for us. He took from us the penalty that we should have taken. Go back and look at the scripture when He hung on the cross, the abuse that He took. He took that so you would not have to take it. Right? So today we ought to be glad that God, that we influenced by God because of the love. Because of the you.